Discord sat sadly upside down tree stump with his head in his hands. First my wife, he uttered, and now my children. I should have known. The only creature you can trust is yourself. As he spoke, Zany appeared in the air before him, bringing a smile to the Draconiquest's face. Ah, my boy, he exclaimed, taking the baby in his arms. You missed Daddy, didn't you? You'll never leave me, right? He had not been caught up in his joy when he noticed the devilish smile on the infant's face. Mothball hiked through the forest, carrying the unconscious mare on his back. His ears perked up as he saw a group of changelings nearby, and he quickly dove down in the bushes. Screwball let out a moan. He silenced her with his hoof. She must be around here somewhere, one of the soldiers said. I smell chocolate milk. The prince gulped, and then he had an idea. He then took a form of the soldier changeling and then leapt out of the hiding place. You dumb bugs miss her, he exclaimed, pointing at the direction. She just went that away. One of the changelings sniffed the air. That he's right. The trail is fresh. We can still catch her. As soon as the three were gone, Mothball picked up Screwball, and then he moved as fast as his legs could carry them both. After a while, he came out of the cross, a strangely decorated, but inside a grand tree. The light was still on, but whoever lived there was still home. Maybe they can help, Mothball thought. He was about to knock on the door when he realized that he was still in his changeling disguise. No pony would assist him while he was looking at that. So he transformed the disguise when he had used earlier with the day with Screwball. He tapped on his now gray hoof on the door. Who's knocking so late? The deep female voice called from inside. I'm coming, please wait. The black and white striped pony stepped out and opened the door. Who are you, stranger? You don't know the danger of being at night at the forest. Please, Mothball pleaded. You have to help me. My friend, she's... The pony's eyes widened at the sight of the unconscious mare. Screwball? Bring her in. Place her on the bed and tell me why she looks near dead. She then can guide her disguised prince over to the bed and help them set Screwball down. Can you please help her? Mothball begged. I can do. Do not stress. What caused her sickness? He bit his lips, and then he knew the mare was a change. If this mare knew he was a changeling, she would kick him out and then keep him away from his Screwball. We do not speak, the pony commanded as she exclaimed to her patient. She is very weak. I could barely feel her heartbeat. I will make her soup for her and eat it so make sure she gets well. Then she will recover. Only time will tell. Mothball watched curiously as she watched the mare search for the shelves for her bottles and flasks. I've never seen any pony like you before, he observed. Oh, that's because I'm a zebra, not a pony, she said, turning to him with a bow. I'm Zecora, the one and only. Oh, well, you know Screwball? The zebra answered his question as she pulled a bottle from the shelf. 17 years ago, her mother came in to ask me comfort about that she was about to agree, and she came close to being the bride of the evil Draconiquest. But I told her that if she went, she would find great happiness. Mothball blinked. You got her parents together? Zecora chuckled throatily as she poured the contents of the bottle into the boiling pot of water. That is so you say you pay? Oh, I'll never forget that day. And she was about to pick up another intelligent when they saw that Mothball was standing with nothing to do. How rude of me. How would you like some tea? He wasn't a fan of tea, but he did not want to reject the zebra's hospitality, so he nodded dumbly. After mixing several of herbs and spices into the cauldron, Zecora muttered something into another language that the prince did not understand. He sipped his tea in disgust and did not even knew what the matter was. All he could think about was how fragile his friend looked, and she lay asleep motionless on the bed beside him. While he held up his cup in one hoof, he held Screwball's hoof on the other. In a few minutes, the soup was ready, and Zecora poured into the bowl and approached the sick mare. Tilt her head back, she said to Mothball. The prince sat up and down his cup and did what the zebra said. As he gently pushed back Screwball's head, her mouth fell open, and the zebra put the bowl of the young mare's lips and slowly poured the soup into her mouth. As soon as she was done, Mothball carefully released Screwball's head, and her mouth closed again. Is she going to be all right? Zecora sighed and pulled the leopard print blanket over the young mare's body. I don't know. As I fear for now, she must rest here. Mothball's eyes gazed over with tears as he laid his hoof on her friend's forehead. Please get better, Screwy. The zebra then picked up Mothball's cup and examined the tea leaves, and her eyes widened in fascination, her lips curling to a smile. How interesting, she murmured. What? The changeling asked before facing the zebra. Zecora smirked at him. It was very more noble of you to help Screwball, something I would not expect from a changeling Prince Mothball. His jaw dropped in surprise. I don't know what you're talking about. The zebra shook her head with a laugh. You can stop the charades. I promise you can stay. He stared at her for a long while and reluctantly changed back into himself. How did you know? Did my eyes give it away? No, Zecora replied, holding a cup of tea. The leaves tell me all. There is no trick in me, Prince Mothball. He sighed and then slumped onto the floor. Please, it's just Mothball. I'm no prince. I'm a traitor to my own kind. Yes, Zecora nodded. You did it because you fell in love with the pony that you were supposed to dispose of. He then raised his eyebrow at her. Are you psychic or something? Instead of answering, the zebra gestured him to sit closely on the table, and he hesitated at the thought for imparting from Screwball. He had just as she requested. After a few seconds, Zecora joined him, with a stack of cards in her hooves. Well, your guess it was only half right, Mothball claimed. Changelings cannot love, let alone fall in love. I don't even have a heart. Are you sure? Zecora asked, tilting her head. After bringing Screwball here for a cure? She's the only friend I ever have. What was I supposed to do? She shook her head. You are so blind that you betray. Let us see what the cards have to say. As she huffed, shuffled the cards on her desk and spread them onto the table. Take three, and I will tell the past, the present, and the future as well. Mothball shrugged and decided to humor the zebra with her game. He took three from the deck and handed them to Zecora. He set them aside face down in the middle and turned over the one on the left. And on the show shows a picture of a dark figure with glowing eyes inside of Mothball made cringe. The devil, Zecora explained. It looks like Screwball's dad. The zebra then threw her head back with a laugh. All the represents of the hell of your past. You have been scolded and harassed. A demon took control of your mind, shaping you and blinding you to your heart. Quite cleverly. As a result, you have been treated unfairly. My mother, you see yourself as a demon, as well as a monster who belongs in hell. You may think you're heartless, emotionless, and bad, but it is these thoughts that make you very sad. Mothball said nothing. Zecora turned over the card in the middle, revealing a white Pegasus with red wings, pouring water from the goblet into another. Your present involves temperance, said the zebra, a symbol of balance. What does that mean? The prince inquired. You haven't given up your habits as a changeling and have left your true emotions take the wing. And all your life, you followed your mother, and then you left that mare for another. The Pegasus wings are red, representing desire, but from what both of the white on your hoof and head, representing purity, and you have combined both in with maturity, and each creature feeds on the love, but now you must share it with that dove. She then pointed to Screwball. So I've changed, Mothball admitted, but I told you, I'm not made to love. Zecora sighed. Of course this, you are sure. Now we will see the future. The last card had two unicorns, a mare, and a colt, staring intensely over at each other with their hooves entwined around their horns touching. Above their horns were glowing pink heart. Zecora smiled at this one. The lovers. Mothball groaned. Let me guess. When it comes to love, your future is bright. Do you believe me now that I'm right? These are a bunch of playing cards. They don't mean anything. The zebra shook her head again. The queen has laid your thoughts astray. Perhaps I can convince you another way. She then circled the table without a warning, placed Mothball's hoofs on her chest. Hey, what do you feel? Zecora inquired immediately. He paused. Your heart? Indeed. Now come. He followed the zebra. Mothball realized something. Hey, how come you stopped talking in the rhyme? Zecora did not answer and pulled the covers off of Screwball, and she took Mothball's hooves again and laid it on Screwball's chest. What do you feel now? Her heart. What does it have to do? He was cut off as the zebra moved his hoof to his own chest, and now something pumped wildly against his hoof, and in a familiar to the thumping inside of Screwball and Zecora, he had felt many times before, but he told himself it was nothing like love that consuming pulsing through him. Then what was that, the exact same place in his chest as Screwball and Zecora's? Where could his heart be? Mothball looked up at the zebra. There has to be an explanation. I'm not supposed to have a heart. What does it mean you cannot? Zecora stated. What else will you fill that spot? If you're heartless, Mothball, how will you explain your feelings for Screwball? The prince then looked at the mare in bed. Some of the color that he had returned to her cheeks, giving her face a gentle glow. It made him smile into this, but also sad that he was not able to, that she was not still awake. I can explain it, he admitted. The moment I saw her, I was bewitched. Sometimes I wonder if she cast a spell on me. but the more time I spent with her, the more I was compelled with me to stay with her. I tried not to, not because I don't want to hurt her, but I kept coming back. I know she loves me, and I've always known I was supposed to feed off of it, but you know something? No matter how much time I spent with her, she never seemed to wither, not like the slightest. I felt her love transfer to me, but her energy never dismissed. I began to assume that she was immune. He hung his head. Well, that's clearly not the case. After what your mother did to her, Mothball noticed something in Screwball shivering, so he pulled her to the covers back on her body. I can't stop thinking about her, he continued. Everything about her, her smile, her laugh, her sense of humor, her hair, her eyes. He sighed, oh, what would I have given to see her again? Do you think she'll get better soon? When she received no answer, Mothball turned his head. The zebra was no longer behind him. Sakura, do not fear. I'm here. He glanced over in the room and found her sitting in a stirring her cauldron. As he approached her, Sakura took a teacup that he had drunk and dumped the leaves into the boiling water. What are you doing now? Mothball asked, peering inside. Sakura took some green powder from the jar and then blew it into it. A green image started to form, making the changelings gasp. As he was soon realizing it, the two silhouettes. One resembled Screwball and the other was himself. And the figures that had both embraced each other bent their bodies in a way that formed into a heart. Suddenly, the image evaporated into thin air, and all remained was a pot of green liquid. What was that? The prince questioned, still in awe. That, Sakura replied, was what happens when you two became one. When they possess a magic more powerful than the sun, then what do you think the weakness is not so? Strength is what comes from the glow. Do you ever get a straight answer? No. He stared at her, and then at Screwball. If nothing changes, I could make more of the stew, the zebra said, but I'll need some herbs and help from you. Mothball turned to Sakura. How can I help? As Screwball gained consciousness, everything came flooding back. Her father's mental breakdown, her unpleasant encounter with Dinky, her mother's supposed betrayal, her brother's turning out to be Chrysalis. Her brother, Zany, she murmured. She then felt something cold on her forehead, causing her to slowly open her eyes. Zany, she said again. Shh, a warm voice whispered. Take it easy, my little filly. Then Screwball's vision came back to focus and saw the zebra smiling over her and pressing a warm, wet cloth on her to her forehead. Sakura, it's good to see that you're awake. Tell me, does everything ache? The young mare groaned. My head. Sakura then looked for a moment and then came back with a cup of tea. Drink this, but not too fast. You'll lack your strength, but the worst part has passed. Screwball struggled up to sit up. How did I get here? How long was I out? For about an hour you were here, and it was one of your friends that brought you here, dear. Really? She asked, sipping the tea. Who? Dinky? One of the twins? Sakura was about to answer, but when her voice interrupted her. Hey, Sakura, I think I found the things you asked for. The gray stallion carried a saddlebag in the doorway. Not knowing Screwball was awake, he transformed to Mothball. The young mare gasped. You! The changeling turned into alarm, but then smiled. You're awake! Thank goodness! Screwball looked accusingly at Sakura. How could you let him in here? Do you have any idea who he is? He is one that saved your life, the zebra replied. I don't know what causes you of this strife. Hmm, the mare huffled. Save my life? My hoof? What even happened to your highness? Don't you want to use your primary food source? Mothball's grin had faded. What are you talking about? Don't play dumb. You've been using me all this time. You told your mother all my secrets. You betrayed me. I thought you were my friend. The prince was confused. Screwy, let me explain. I trusted you. Screwball, please lie down, Sakura started to say. No, she screamed. I won't be in the same room with him. Suddenly, the pillows flew off the bed and zoomed towards Mothball. He managed to duck just in time. Screwy, please, he begged. But the mare was already up and running towards the door. You don't have much strength, Sakura yelled. Mothball moved in the front of the mare. Changelings are looking for you. It's not safe out there, Screwball scowled. I don't care, as long as I'm away from you. She then pushed him out of the way and raced outside. She did not even know where she was going. She just wanted to get as far away from him as possible, and yet her heart was still telling her to go back, but she would not listen. She could not trust her heart anymore. It did not take long for her to run out of breath. She still gained some strength during her past and rest, but not enough to teleport. She panted with thirst and spotted a river nearby. She kneeled out for a drink and caught her reflection, making her pause. The mare was in the water just looked like her, only paler and broken. She sobbed. This is all my fault. If I haven't been so foolish, if I had listened to Daddy, none of this would have happened. I'd still be at home with my friends, family, my friend Zany. Her little brother was the deepest regret. The The poor infant had done nothing wrong, and yet he was still paying price for her actions. Screwball looked down at her head. No, not this. This was Mothball. He tricked me. If that was the case, then why would he not stop thinking about it, how hurt that he had looked down? Then he looked what it has been rushed for. Why hasn't that sweeper of the Sakura brought her in the first place? Why had not been taking her to Chrysalis? Why did her heart still ache all this time? She looked down at the reflection again and splashed the water fiercely. I don't want to think anymore, she brawled. Then she buried her face in her hooves, not hearing Mothball as he came out of the trees. She looked at him with sad eyes, wanting to wrap her four legs around to assure everything was all right. She had every right to be upset with him, but he could not help but feel the guilty. He had to let her know how he felt, but he wasn't sure, or basically how he was just not disguised as a pony, ended with nothing loose. He was a changeling itself. After what he had done, she would have believed in him. He had thought of going back to the night of the Grand Galloping Gala when they danced together, and she looked so beautiful. Then he realized at some point that night that he had fallen utterly and completely in love with her. Then he started remembering the song, how strangely fixed the lyrics of their relationship. It gave him an idea. It was corny, but it was the only way he can do to express himself. He then started to sing. Screwball's head shot up at the sound of his voice. She turned around and curiously approached him, Her instincts told her to run, but she kept her heart fat in a faster pace. Mothball gulped as he continued. Screwball then raised an eyebrow at him, slightly confused over why he was singing. It wasn't the sweetest of his voices, but it was nervousness in his tone. But it was not horrible. He held out his hoof, but she turned away. Mothball was hurt, but he would not give up. He choked in his words. Screwball could face him again, and her eyes were wide, remembering the song from the gala next to the lyric. Could it be? And Mothball was struggling so hard, he skipped the verse altogether, and then one the other. He reached out his hoof again. This time, she let him touch her. Screwball then turned the rest of the body as he laid his hooves on her shoulders. And this was something she never expected. She wanted to keep listening, but her mind told her to take a control of herself and wrench out of his grasp. She walked away with her head down, but Mothball was determined to not lose her again. He sang louder with more passion. Screwball stopped in her tracks. Since the first day I met you, she slowly turned his head back to him. She was now looking directly into his emerald eyes. They were so sincere and so sad, so desperate in a way that no creature could possibly fake. She could not need her power to tell the truth to them. Screwball turned fully towards him, extended his fore leg to her. I love you, Scurry. The young mare could not contain her emotion any longer, and did not hesitate and rush to his embrace.